The service next Sunday will be conducted by the Reverend George Lind, your interim moderator, and he's going to be looking after emergency pastoral issues too. Knitted teddies for Malawi will be on display today in the halls. Thanks to all who've contributed to this cause. The Banana Box Trust will deliver these for a donation of £15 per box. So if any wish to contribute, please do so. Prayer time is held on Wednesday at 2 o'clock here. So please join our worship leader, Lynn, for a time of peaceful, quiet reflection. She's unable to be here today. She's just got a wee health problem. Please remember in prayer the folk of Relief Bourtry Hill Church who've had their final service in their sanctuary this morning. Tears and fears were expressed. So please make sure those who come will receive a very, very warm welcome. I'm sure you'll do that. To place flowers in the sanctuary, please add your name to the list at the door. The Kirk Session meets next on Wednesday, the 14th of July at 7:30 in Relief Church and Hall. Please let Jean Carr know if you intend to be there by Sunday, the 11th July. An emergency appeal has been launched by Christian Aid as 30 million people in 20 countries are on the brink of famine and therefore starvation. The COVID pandemic, violent conflict, and climate change have all increased global hunger. If any can help in any way, there will be a collection plate in the vestibule today and next Sunday for any who wish to respond to this appeal. Alison Muir sent me an email yesterday. She's asked me to intimate that Crossing Together, that's the group formed between Dreghorn and Springside and this church, are holding a pop-up table event in the Venal between 10:30 and 2:30 on Saturday, 3rd of July. They're to hand out craft materials to encourage folk to think about prayer and to advertise Crossing Together as a new outreach. You're invited to visit the Venal on Saturday and make yourself known. That'd be good if you do that. Now, our communion hymn is a modern version of Amazing Grace. It's called Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. So let's just sit and listen to this and sing it in our minds and imaginations. invite you all, whoever you are, to come and join this sacramental meal, which we shall now share together. The Church of Scotland has what's called an open table, which means that all of any denomination or none who wish to take communion may do so in response to Jesus' invitation to come. So come and receive, even if you feel your faith is weak, even if, and especially if you feel unworthy, come and take communion. For what makes us able to take this is the humble recognition that each of us needed the sacrifice of Christ for our sins. That sacrifice is what we celebrate in this sacrament. None of us was ever worthy of that, but we come in surprised gratitude to receive all he will give us. And he says, come to me, all of you who are weak and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him. He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall never hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. So communion is for all who will respond to Christ's invitation to come. So let us draw near to the table of our Lord. And with these words of authority, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. As the Lord Jesus, the night before he was betrayed, took bread, I take these elements of bread and of wine to be set apart from all common uses to this holy use and mystery. And as he gave thanks and blessed, let us draw near to God and present to him our prayers and thanksgivings. So let us pray. Father in heaven, we rejoice that you're a God of amazing grace. We're astounded at the lengths that you should go to win us to yourself and from our ways of sin and death. Here we celebrate the giving of your Son for us, who came to live our life and to die our death, and to raise us up to eternal life with you in your kingdom. Here we come to celebrate the life you give us today, abundant and full, overflowing with the Spirit of the living Christ and saturated in his love. Here we come to celebrate our life together in Christ as we gather around his family table and as we break bread, symbolizing his broken body, and as we pour out wine, symbolizing his life poured out for our salvation. Lord, we confess our need of your grace today, for we have sinned in word, thought, and deed. We are weak in our wills and give in all too quickly to selfish pursuits. We confess we try too much in our own strength and neglect to seek your face in the decisions that we have to make and in the challenges of the life you call us to live. So here we come to celebrate the full and free forgiveness of all our sins, and to receive once again the strengthening that comes through our union and communion with you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So now we present to you the sum and substance of our lives, in private and in public, alone and in relationships, to be accepted, used, and glorified by you in the service of Christ, whose yoke is easy, and whom to follow is to walk in the light. In his precious name we pray. Amen. We do this in obedience to Christ's example and command, who on the same night in which he was betrayed took bread, and after he'd given thanks to God, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in memory of me. So let us eat this, the bread of heaven, and be strengthened thereby. the same way he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me." So let us drink this, the cup of salvation, and know that our sins are forgiven, and we may savor the joy of new life. Jesus rose from the dead, he stood among his disciples, and he said, "Peace be with you. In Christ's name I say to you, the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you." Let us pray. Lord, we humbly thank you for all your goodness to us at our Lord's table. By your Spirit, you make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until that day that Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet, spread for all his saints. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, with the Holy Spirit and your holy people, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore. Amen. Now, Karen, sing.
It's a peace that the world cannot give. It's a peace that the world cannot understand. Peace to know, peace to live. My peace I give unto you. My joy I give unto you. It's a joy that the world cannot give. It's a joy that the world cannot understand. Joy to know, joy to joy I give unto you. My love I give unto you. It's a love that the world cannot give. It's a
Now David's going to give a reading this morning from Philippians 3, verses 1 to 14.
The true righteousness. In conclusion, my friends, be joyful in your union with the Lord. I don't mind repeating what I have written before, and you will be safer if I do so. Watch out for those who do evil things, those who insist on cutting the body. It is we, not they, who have received the true circumcision, For we worship God by means of his Spirit and rejoice in our life in union with Christ Jesus. We do not put any trust in external ceremonies. I could, of course, put my trust in such things. If any of you think you can trust in these external ceremonies, I have even more reason to feel that way. I was circumcised when I was a week old. I am an Israelite by birth, of the tribe of Benjamin, a pure-blooded Hebrew. As far as keeping the Jewish law is concerned, I was a Pharisee, and I was so zealous that I persecuted the church. As far as a person can be righteous by obeying the commands of the law, I was without fault. But all those things that I might count as profit, I now reckon as loss for Christ's sake. Not only those things, I reckon everything as complete loss for the sake of what is so much more valuable, the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have thrown everything away. I consider it all as mere garbage, so that I may gain Christ and be completely united with him. I no longer have a righteousness of my own, the kind that is gained by obeying the law. I now have the righteousness that is given through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is based on faith. All I want is to know Christ and to experience the power of his resurrection, to share in his sufferings and become like him in his death, in the hope that I myself will be raised from death to life. I do not claim that I already have succeeded or have already become perfect. I keep striving to win the prize for which Christ Jesus has already won me to himself. Of course, my friends, I really do not think that I have already won it. The one thing I do know, however, is to forget what is behind me and to do my best to reach to what is ahead. So I run straight forward towards the goal in order to win the prize, which is God's call through Christ Jesus to the life above. Amen.
Thank you very much, David. Thank you. Recently, governments did something unusual. They admitted they made mistakes, like the one to send hospital patients into care homes. That caused many deaths. The film star Britt Ekland recently admitted she made a mistake in getting lip filler. Now she can model for a cartoon character, if you've seen a picture of her today. Joyce Meyer, the TV preacher, made a similar mistake with plastic surgery to her mouth. Now she looks more like a goldfish. The Roman Catholic Church has admitted it made grave mistakes in the realm of child abuse and has damaged its reputation. But the Church of Scotland must admit it's made one huge mistake. We've done a terrible thing with Jesus. We've domesticated him. We've made a tabby cat out of a roaring lion, a dairy cow out of a raging bull. We've softened his challenge, cheapened his grace, confused the gospel message. Worst of all, says one preacher, we've violated the 11th commandment, which is, thou shalt not make God boring. If that is so, then what does it cost Scotland and what does it cost us, the Church of Scotland? Well, I think we know. Obviously, we don't know how many people have come through the doors of our churches earnestly seeking some spiritual experience, only to leave disappointed, or who came in with open hearts, but left with them closed. You know, we've all seen them once and never again. So what do? To whom do we turn? How about to Paul? You remember his story? His Jesus was powerful and life-transforming. He never lacked passion about anything, but that passion was redirected very dramatically on the Damascus Road. After that meeting, everything Paul says and does is about one thing, as a writer has put it, trying to throw words and deeds at his experience of Jesus Christ. That's the mark of actually meeting Jesus. Things get changed. What we think about God, what we think about ourselves and others, all changes. And each of Paul's letters are about this. Paul's confidence was the first thing that changed. Before he met Christ, he had confidence in his pedigree. confidence in his ability to keep the rules as a Pharisee, even confidence in persecuting the church. But something happened. His confidence totally shifted. His balance sheet changed. What was gain became loss. What was foolishness became foundational. Once we encounter Jesus and really start being faithful to him, things change. But when we soft pedal God's word, we lose all the strident tones of the gospel. We lose our ability to be bold, and our confidence in our message disappears. We just echo what society says instead of addressing it. Society does not want an echo of what it thinks. It wants to have a clear message from God. This is what the church is called to have in this present age: a clear, confident, bold message. Bold about God, because God has been bold in love towards us in Jesus. Nothing in the world can match that. We've made a firecracker into a damp squib, and young people and inquirers are the first to recognize that this has happened to us. But we see churches thrive when they exist as an outreach of God's love and transforming power to their communities. They make strides for God, and most of them are new churches. Hey, haven't we got two new churches? One going up in Relief Birchill Hill, one here, Muir Relief. These new churches have confidence in God. Without God confidence, there's no power. Without power, there's no transformation. And no transformation, what's the point? If folk don't get converted through you and me, then the church has no future. It's impossible to reconcile our modern take or leave it faith with Paul's faith, or worse, our modern, oh, if it's convenient faith, with Paul's loyal, 100% committed faith. Paul found something in Jesus that emboldened him to forfeit his previously privileged life. In fact, Paul's faith is made up of things forfeited and wonderful things gained. Let me tell you about Jim. Jim was my former church officer. He was a retired police officer when I came to Ayr. He helped a lot around the church, fixing things in the buildings, including the manse. He was an absolute gem. But as a widower, life was a bit dull. One day, we had folk to our church from Tear Fund, and Jim was inspired. He found he could serve with a team abroad, even though he was over 60. His first trip was to Guinea-Bissau, when he worked in a wonderful place with the name Bambadinka. There he really got the bug for serving others in Christ's name and for sharing his faith. Next was Honduras in Central America, and a place again with a wonderful name, Tegucigalpa. I heard these names plenty of times. Actually, in the next 10 to 20 years, yet well into his 70s, he went 11 times with Tear Fund to different countries worldwide, and then with Baptist missions to Belarus and Croatia. Now, it cost him a lot. He had to pay for these trips out of his own pocket. All these together came to thousands upon thousands of pounds. And he gave thousands of hours of laboring for churches and communities in often remote places in the world. Some, no doubt quite a few, thought Jim absolutely daft for spending so much of his retirement years that way, and for spending his police pension that way. Jim would have replied that he received far, far more in return. And he had riches of spirit and life that just shone from him. He passed away a few weeks ago, aged 91, and I was privileged to conduct his funeral. Jim was one of my life's heroes. I wonder if our faith, wonder if my faith, resembles anything like Jim's or Paul's. And if not, why not? Today, most of us, if we're honest, scarcely want to be inconvenienced for Christ's sake, let alone actively forfeit anything. Just look at the cajoling that has to go on in most churches for time and money needed for mission. Will Muir Relief pour funds into creating a new church in Birchie Hill? Will it grasp with both hands that wonderful opportunity? Or will it squander it in committee fights over budgets and bank accounts? Will maintenance always come before mission? If it does, you're finished. Like the Bible story, we become the rich man and made Jesus the poor beggar who sits at the gate. So many out there still believe in God, but they wonder if the church still believes in God. Paul's motto was this: to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. The world and the church need folk like that. And Paul gave us clear indications on how to get back on track. He had a goal-orientated faith, and that's what we need. And that goal has three parts. Step one, forget what lies behind. Jesus has redeemed the past and bought us a future with his love. So don't get stuck in the past. You're free. Those whom the Son has set free are free indeed. You can really do as much as you want within the Church of Scotland. Enormous freedom. If you have ideas for here or up the road, little can stop you. So go for it and don't dwell in the past. Step two, strain forward. Moving forward with Jesus takes some work. You have to confront your fears. Christianity is not for cowards, but for the spiritually athletic. It teaches us exactly the way we need to be stretched when we use our faith. So go on, use your imagination, pray about your ideas, and strive to accomplish what God lays on your heart, even if your heart's thumping within you. Never think the end has come. Go and make a new future for yourself and for the church here in Irvine. Step three, press on towards the goal of your heavenly calling. Followers of Jesus aren't obsessed with being good people like most folk out there. Now our goal is to glorify God. We do so by pressing on towards our heavenly calling. So don't say you've no opportunity. You're part of the worldwide Church of Jesus. It's calling you upward every day. We've been called to release heaven wherever we are, wherever we find ourselves. And more of heaven gets released every day when you and I press on with Jesus. Forgiveness is from heaven. He tells us to forgive. So his love tells us to love. Peace, joy, generosity, kindness, and hope. Press on towards this at home, at work, and in this community, wherever you are. Listen to these final words of an American preacher. Pressing on with Jesus is our calling. Pressing on with a God in stuff that is beyond our asking or imagining. A God who came among us gently, lived wonderfully, taught truthfully, died violently, was risen triumphantly, empowers generously, and remains our companion steadfastly. No words can contain it. No effort can attain it. Shame on us if we constrain it. The best thing is to proclaim it. And may this be so in this church in the future. David is going to lead us.
Let's come together now before God in prayer. Let us pray. Our gracious, loving God, who is patient with us and is patient with our world, we come in prayer thanking you for all the blessings we enjoy in our lives, so many of which we take for granted, and of which millions in our world can only dream. Lord, as we begin to overturn the COVID virus, we pray you would enable us to do what is logical and sensible to benefit our community. Thank you for the high rate of the vaccinations that we enjoy and the hopes these will bring of new freedom. Lord, may other nations come to experience these too, remembering especially Brazil, now with over 500,000 deaths and almost every family touched with sorrow. Lord, have mercy, and grant wisdom to Brazil's leaders and to the leaders of other nations which also are struggling to cope, and especially those with so few vaccines for their population. We are grateful that the G7 promised to send billions to poorer nations. May such promises become realities as soon as possible. We remember many folks in our land suffering from long COVID. Lord, speed the research into this, and let there be cures created and recovery found. We pray now for the future of the Church of Scotland and the decision made to reduce ministries and churches. Lord, we pray for so many who could be hurt, so many who may feel abandoned, so many who will feel bereft of their spiritual roots, especially the older generation. We pray that in the new union of Muir Relief, that all will feel at home and as one in Christ with all here. Lord, bless and prosper this union for the good of Irvine and the glory of God. May the priorities of mission and growth in Christ lead all activities, and may your blessing rest upon our mission pioneer, Alison Muir. May she find strong support as her work takes place in our parishes for the glory of your name. We pray for a new minister to be appointed to bring an end to the long spell of vacancy. May you guide our interim moderator, the session, members, and the future nominating committee to the person of your choosing. And so may we have a new future of hope to be welcomed in. In the immediate future, may the worship leaders and all who conduct services here and the elders and the office bearers find mutual support and prayer support as together they seek to honour our Lord and draw his people into worship and service. Let there be unity, and let there be love of one another, and a sincere commitment to work for the highest and the best. We remember now all known to us who are in need of our prayers. We name them in the silence before you. Lord, hear our prayers. Lord, now we ask your blessing on our offerings, which we dedicate to you today. May they help to bring comfort to the dying, healing to the sick, light to those living in darkness, and hope to all people who look to you. We ask for this for Jesus' sake. Amen. Stuart, could I go for just 1 minute longer?
In order to say thank you very much. Last 18 months, under very difficult circumstances, we had a linkage, we had a union, we had socially distant worship, we had a pandemic with online worship, and
we managed to stay together throughout all that time.
And it's with
thanks to you.
That you helped us to make this happen.
So thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
And
thank you. Well, that's very kind of you. Thank you. That's very, very kind and really unnecessary. Can I just thank you first as a congregation for all your support and friendship to my wife, who's had an interesting year, a year that she would have preferred to forget, but she's had an enormous amount of support from members and friends here, and from our interim moderator, who's with us this morning, but he's sitting quietly. He's going to take the services next Sunday. But I thank him for his support over these last couple of years. I haven't been able to do I couldn't have done this without a team. I'm really pretty useless technically, and so I've had to depend 100% on others when I've produced videos or sent hymns or whatever, prayers. I've had to depend on folk to make the final production, and that's been a challenge for me and a greater challenge for David and the others when they see what I've landed them with. done extremely well and have enabled these services to take place week after week. We have had a few technical difficulties recently, and I hope and pray that these can be solved. I'm sure they will be, and there'll be a superb service here every week. Thanks for all your blessings from behalf of Sandra and myself, and I look forward to seeing great things happening with Muir Relief here and up the road. So every blessing to you. Thanks very much indeed. Thank you. And I don't think you'll ever have to suffer this again. It's very, very awkward, isn't it? Peeling back and drinking that. So I hope that we'll be free of that the next time. So we close our service in singing the hymn, Facing a Task Unfinished That Drives Us to Our Knees.
Thank you.
peace in the strength of the Lord. Go in the knowledge that Jesus gave his all for you because he loves you. Go with the Spirit of God filling your heart with love for God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you this day and dwell with you now and forevermore. Amen.